As introduction, I have some images from the museum and I want to show you what's going on there. Let me introduce you myself. I'm not the director of the museum. I'm head of exhibitions and I'm curator for exhibitions, for detail exhibitions. And I'm here with my colleague, Renate Langenfelder. She's not the director too, but she's responsible for a very important department in our house. She's responsible for educational programs, and but she's calling her department Museum and Public. And I think it's one of the most important in our house because it's working with the visitors. It's not only for programs for younger visitors, it's also for programs for elder visitors. She's responsible for all the events, for opening and closing ceremonies, but she's also doing excursions and journeys with our visitors, with the members of the museums, the friend of the museums, and we have about more than 6,000 members of a society for the museum. And within 2 weeks, she will have a trip to Zagreb, to Krapina. So you see, there is a close connection between Salzburg and Croatia. So I will show you what we have done and what the contents is of this museum. You can see it on these both slides and my lectures under the title of Information and Entertainment at the Same Time. So we want to give information about the history of the city and the country of Salzburg, but on the other side we want to have entertainment for them so that it is fun and that they enjoy the visit. You see on the left side an outside picture, you see it is a 400-year-old palace. And when it was decided in 2000 to establish the museum there, we had really hard problems to make this house or to change this house from the interior and exterior into a modern museum. So it was really hard work of 6 years and we had to think of the contents. And now we established a museum, what we call, it's not a real English word or in real English sentence, it's a museum of three speeds. So we divided the different floors of the houses into different speeds of exhibition. We have a special exhibition hall, that's the modern part of the house, down under the courtyard. And it's for short-term exhibitions, as we get loans for 3 or 4 months, something like this. We have a semi, what I call semi-permanent exhibition on the second floor. It's based on personalities, so we call it Salzburg Personally, or Salzburg Personalities. These exhibitions, about 13 rooms in one queue, depends, or the duration depends on money, on the possibility of the staff, and also of special dates. We're celebrating 100 birthday or 200 years of dying of a person. I will show you that further on. And the permanent exhibition on the next floor, on the third one, the so-called permanent exhibition, is based on topics, and it's called How Salzburg Became Its Myth and How Does It Work With This. First of all, I will show you the floors of our house. This is down here is Mozart Place, so we're absolutely in the historic city center. You can step in here, you're reaching at a large courtyard, then you come in the museum, the cash desk, an information room, but also used for exhibitions, for discussions, concerts, and so on. And you see, this first floor is only for the structure of the house. The green parts are belonging to the museum. The others are still in parts of the government, so it was absolutely completely to have this network together and to try to divide the two parts. And then we have a shop in here that is not belonging to the museum. So that's the second floor we have. As we got it, before we got it in 2000, the house, it was an office, or inside were offices of the government. So there are a lot of different small rooms built in the last 2 centuries to use them for their meetings, for the working people, for the government, and we had to deconstruct these rooms so that we get space for exhibitions. So we can walk in this area once around the courtyard. If you come up the staircase, you can walk once around, and we have those large rooms. As they are historic buildings, we have always a problem to handle the historic rooms, and these are not the white cubes, every curator wants to have it. The same in the next floor, on the third floor, I want to show you now with the slides. This was the situation about 2000. Here we have the whole floor We have representative rooms of the archbishops in here, as you can see, with ceiling decorations I will show you. And the others were the small rooms, all the every time offices with the windows. We cleared it like this, so that we have really space for each exhibition. The space is about 3,000 square meters now. Space total is 2.73. In the basement, a special exhibition hall of about 500 square meters, two floors, 950, 1,290, with other parts that are dedicated for educational programs, for special events, for small concerts. It's about 3,000 square meters of showrooms. Two photos on the period of construction. To the left side, you see that we tried to connect the historic building with a modern exhibition hall, and we built down under the courtyard, you see on the right side, and the exhibition hall with about 500 square meters. We tried to use every centimeter, so you can see that we cut really down to the cellars, the walls. This was inside, you see, deconstructing the walls, the offices, was a really hard job and took a long time for planning and for realizing this. But I think if you compare it with the right side, with the exhibition rooms, you can see the success or the result. That's the courtyard we have. If the weather is as beautiful as it is in Dubrovnik, we can use this for opening ceremonies like this. Planning is always a hard job because Salzburg is really a city of rain most of the time. But if we have luck and we have evenings like yesterday in the archives over there, they're really beautiful opening ceremonies, and the courtyard we colored it after looking for historic colors with these red ribbons around, as you saw it. And it's really an Italian style of Renaissance courtyard, and it's very comfortable for the things. That's the entrance, main entrance, where we put last year the award, the trophy from the European Museum Forum as an entrance to the museum, but also as an introduction as with the result what we did the last years, the last 10 years. Then you enter the cash desk, where the shop is. You see on the right side, this is the director. This is Dr. Max. He's entering his museum, maybe. But as necessary or as important as he is always the staff that is working at the entrance. The period, so I think it's one of the most important things to work with the visitor staff. We don't call them for working at the cash desk, info desk, at wardrobe, or in the showrooms. They're not really the guards in the museum. We call them visitors service. They are in front of the visitor from the entrance to the exit, and I want to tell you that we did a lot of training with them during the period when we have closed. So we want really that they identify themselves with our museum, with the contents and with the structure. So they were not unemployed these 7 years of constructing the museum. They're really working with us in the exhibition rooms, but they also had a lot of training. Training how to behave in the museum, how to identify, how to work with disabled people. But we also do how to stand in a museum during 8 years of opening hours. So they had also yoga training or something like this. They had training with blind people. They had association training, language training. So it's really necessary to go and work with this. And Renate and me, we're still working for this. And they, now, at the first, they were very angry about it. They hesitated. And now they're asking, when is the next training? When can we do something again? So I think they're as important as we are, the academic staff in the house. You see the shop, we run them, we run the shop ourselves. Most of the products are produced in the house, catalogs, brochures, but also merchandising products, because I don't want to be a souvenir shop with those typical Salzburg, Mozart, and some things, souvenirs. Most of the things are produced in the house and for the house and with objects and elements that fits with the house. I will start with the third floor, going up and down, because this is the permanent exhibition. And there we're telling the story how Salzburg became its muse. Where does it come from? Where does it go to? Related to the to our days, to the what is now important for the city. And we don't tell it in a chronological way. We are basing this on stories. So we start in about the period of 1820 with these landscapes you can see over there. After Napoleon Wars, the painters, the authors, they came back to Salzburg. They praised the city, the situation of the small town between the hills, and they are really the first who were making advertisement for this. So you see on the walls our paintings from the period that shows the town, but also the landscape surrounding the town. And in the middle you have some an opportunity or a possibility to get in the subject more in detail. We have those graphic panels. Yeah, visitors can use. They're put inside. They can move it as it is in a library. They can open things and they can find therein more detailed information. For us, it gives the possibility to put these paperworks longer on display because they are hidden behind these fans, these folding possibilities, and so the visitor is asked to be interactive without any screen. I don't want to have in each of the rooms 10 screens where he can touch or they can work, but they're really acting with the original objects inside. The next room is dedicated to the development of the tourism, because when the painters came and they praised our country, they spread it out all over Europe, and then tourism comes back again. So in 1860, the main station was built and then it brought tourism. This was really the start of what now is the hype. And we're also getting up to our days, because it's connected always with 2 days. So the hype in Salzburg is Mozart, the music, and the Salzburg Festival. So we're also telling the story of today, of the problems of these Salzburg festivals, the hype of the tourism, as it is a little bit in Dubrovnik the same, that it's crowded with tourists and that it is looking for the own identity. So if you see on these cylinders, they can be moved by the visitors. And there you can see in front, these are the men and the women that are now working in the tourism backstage. We are also asking visitors for their opinions. So this is a topic on architecture, as it was changed in the 18th, in the 19th, or the 20th century. And we are asking them for their opinion. And they are cut out some parts of newspapers to the left from 1850, 1890, and to the right from today. So in the morning when I have breakfast and there's something interesting in the newspaper, I cut it out. When I come to the office, I put it there in the next to the showcase. So it's changing all the days. I said it's a permanent exhibition, but something is moving every time. For instance, I told you the Salzburg Festival is the hype of the tourism. We have a showcase in the center outside with photos of the conductors, of the actors, of the singers, and but also of the society that comes with all the results of this to the Salzburg Festival, positive for the media, but negative for the people living in Salzburg. And in this showcase we show wardrobes, we show costumes from the wardrobe of the festival, sorry, and we're changing them all the time. I get it only for 3 or 4 months, these textiles, and we have to change it. So you see, permanent exhibition is not really permanent. This is a room where we present the citizens of Salzburg, because after the period of the archbishops and of Napoleon, they had to establish themselves, they had to govern the country. We tell this with this wall of the portraits, and we let them tell the story on their own. As an example, we have a decoration, a wallpaper decoration, that's cut out from newspapers from the town. And if somebody is looking, well, what's written there? Was it only decoration or something else? We hit original newspaper cuttings, and if you read the text that are between the portraits, you feel or you find that the text fits with the portraits. This is not the base for where the visitors got the information, but if somebody looks at it, he can really find it, oh, that's not only decoration, that's really fitting to the pictures. So it's different steps of giving information to our visitors. In here you can see a small part that's very important of our house that was developed by Renate and her colleagues. We established a so-called children's world, Kinderwelt in German. There are some hidden rooms inside in this room with the portraits of the burghers, of the citizens, they can step under this vault and they found inside a small room, like this. They are allowed, everybody is allowed for sure, the visitors can do this, but it's only 50 centimeters high, so normally it's used by younger visitors. They step inside and inside they found, they will find books, pictures, games from the time where the portraits were painted, and that's in all the rooms, or in most of the rooms, children can find something. They get at the entrance a small leaflet, a small book, where they can collect stamps, and where they find the logo, it's a little wolf called Wodi, because the archbishop who built the house, his name was Wolf Dietrich, so it's a German game with the word, and inside are rooms like this. Or sometimes they find this logo down on the bottom, they can step behind, and if you open it, you can see simple games behind. It's a room where we have a table with dishes from the 17th century, and then they can have these dishes for the farmers or for the citizens. For sure, we're also very free, and we're working a lot on this topic, guided tours for blind and for disabled people, and the structures you can see is quite necessary, but normal, what's maybe a new idea is that we have all the text information blind people can get in Braille letters. They can get it at the entrance. They took it from one room to the next, and so they get an impression what's presented, what is on display. But Renate is doing a lot of things with people who are not able to hear, people who are not able to see, partly to touch some objects or textile where it is not as bad or something like this. And at the moment we have an exhibition in cooperation with the Salzburg Festival on these dresses, these costumes that were worn by singers. They are not so problematic. Next rooms are the Archbishop's representative rooms. So you see not the white cube as I told at the beginning, but really historic rooms with ceiling decoration, with these old Baroque paintings of the archbishops. It was really hard to tell the story, to bring the information to the visitors. We don't want to have in front of all these archbishops panels with their dates and what they have done. And so we introduced these small screens here, four in this room. And on these screens you see the same height as the visitor is, two actors. Normally we only hear their voice in our audio guide because we have a voice of dialogues. Not teachers, not the academic staff, but visitors as we are in our museum, and they are discussing, they are speaking, they are a little quarreling about the different subjects, and in this room they are here as actors. And the surprise is that they are moving around in this, they are changing from here to there and then to the next one, so it's really a surprise to step inside, to hear what they are talking about, these archbishops, and then they are walking around as visitors are doing themselves. Maybe you can here have a little bit an impression of this. In the next room, you see those stucco decorations on the ceiling from about 1600, and under this roof, or under this heaven of the archbishops, we built this glass house, and in this glass house, visitors can step inside. They are the products of the citizens of Salzburg at the time. And the question is, the burghers of Salzburg between compliance and expulsions, how do they live? What do they feel? How do they act or react against the archbishops? And what is the really necessary things? The positive and the negative results of these archbishops. Archbishop is shown there. For example, we're also dealing with the immigration of the Protestants, because the archbishop was the political ruler and also the head of the church, the Catholic Church, so Jews and Protestants had always been a problem for this reign, and they had to go away in the Middle Ages, but also in the 17th and the 18th century, and we are dealing with this. So this palace of an archbishop is now not only to give him the glory, but also to deal with the problems they had at the moment, like this. At the end, we have a summary and a short film. You will step inside a little bit later on three screens. You see again our actors. The lady on the left, she's in an office, a white office, and she's connected with the man, normally to see on the screen in the center. and they go in through the city to look where the myth of Salzburg is coming from, where it's based on. And it's done in a quite modern way, a little bit of CSI Miami or some series like this, to get in touch also with younger visitors in the house. On the right side you see a map where they are in town. And first they go by car, and she's sent from the office, she's sending him all these historic views of the town to compare it now with our days. On the second floor, we have it based on personalities. When we thought of this subject, I asked my colleagues, whom can we present there? And within 2 weeks, I got a list of more than 200 people that can be presented here, because there is a special birthday, 200th birthday or something else. We have something in the collection. We know someone who is related with these persons. He's important for Salzburg history, and this is not only Mozart or somebody else. These are also cooks from our days, composers, actors, authors, painters, sculptors for sure, men and women working for literature, and so we often have the possibility to change this. I will show you three rooms with three different exhibitions in the same size. This is the first room. When we opened in 2007, it was dedicated to Mr. Schiffmann, Jules Schiffmann. He was director in the last century in the museum, and he was painted at the same time. A combination that would not be possible nowadays, I think. You see him also with his paintings to the left side, and has it decorated the museum to the right side. The combining element is this introduction panel with a large photo from the person who is on display, with one object in this small showcase and a summary, about 400 points only. That's the summary, the first introduction test. For the next exhibition, it was like this. Leopold Kohr was a politician and economist from our days, died in 1994. It is absolutely different. You see this element is the same, but also the design, the architecture is absolutely different between these exhibitions. And so it's no problem if I take out one of these exhibitions and make after 3 months or 1 year another one, because it's always, the graphic design is always the same. Second room, dedicated to a family of painters from this period, with a film show here, but also with objects visitors can open, with some displays, you have books and old catalogues here, and this was it's the same view. In the next exhibition, you see it's a little bit similar with these objects. It was dedicated to a painter from the 18th century, with I did here a hanging in a Baroque style with a ladder that can be moved by the visitors to get close in contact with this painting. The next, the third room, in the first time dedicated to a singer who was really famous on the world stages, then to a painter, and next to a composer. Every time the same view in this room, so you see we're changing all the time. And it can look like this. For example, on the right side down, you see a singer dedicated to a dancer and dance teacher. So the architecture is moving like this. Or the black one on the right side up above is dedicated to a doctor, philosopher. The visitors can open their door they want to have and get inside to get information. In the basement, we have this modern white cube for the short-term exhibitions. And it's looking like this when we have paintings from our own on display, or with objects like this, the Keramis from the 20th century, or a large exhibition of last year, we put the view of Salzburg from the last 5 centuries on display. At the end, I want to show you a new idea of our house, because we are really looking for sustainability. We are using LED light in the house. We developed this with a company that specialized on this, and what's really new is that we use this LED also for spots, for wall washes, as you can see them here. This is the first room. We have up above here those LED lights, and you can see absolutely the same. They are really low energy, they are long duration, take about 50,000 hours of working without infrared, without ultraviolet, and so they're really good in using it with the comes by term necessary case. And here you see that Harald Leitner is the chief of the technical staff with these spots in LED, and directly at the spot he can change the light so that we have here more the blue one and here more the red one, parts of the colors. So it's, it can be changed by each of these spots here so that we have different atmosphere, different light in the rooms. We also use this in rooms like this. This is a room where we present treasures from the medieval art and from the archaeological department. And we decided to make it quite dark, and we don't want to have the descriptions inside the showcases. So we lighted them with LED in here. It's up in there. And you can see, although it's quite dark inside, you can really read it perfectly like this. So it's enlightened in here, up in here, down under, there's a little mirror inside the plexi panel, and it's absolutely the same from up above to down under. Also in this showcase you have already seen is this LED. We always think about how to enlight dishes inside a showcase, and we had the possibility to bring the light from up above, then you have the shadow down under, or from in front, then you have the shadow on the shoulders. Now we lighted the panels inside. The light is going up and down at the same, and so it's absolutely the same in all levels. Yeah, and at the end I want to show you how visitors see our museum. We did a film, it's called Shortcuts, and within the 3 minutes or 4 minutes you will see about the 3,000 square meters in our house. Thank you.
guten Appetit. Dem Bild nach müsste das Kieselgebäude sein. Jetzt ein Büro- und Geschäftshaus mit historischer Restarchitektur. Das ist der Kapuzinerberg. Da waren wir schon. Nein, nein, bleib drauf. Ich schick dir was Interessantes.
Diese Scheußlichkeiten haben sie abgerissen. Zum Glück.
Nie gebaut.
Da war also einst ein Stadtviertel. Und die Bewohner?
Umgesiedelt.
Da hat sich Wolf Dietrich nicht beliebt gemacht. Deshalb haben ihn die Bürger eingelocht.
Nein. Sein Nachfolger Marcus Sitticus war es, der den heutigen Dom begonnen hat. Erzbischof Baris Lodron setzte den Dombau fort und weihte ihn 1628 als Zeichen der katholischen Gegenreformation mitten im Dreißigjährigen Krieg.
For your attention.